I'd like to welcome you to Hope United Methodist Church. I'm glad that you're here worshiping with us this day, on this day that's going to be nice, and that you're going to want to get outside and maybe do some walking or other sorts of things. I would refer you to the announcements that are in your bulletin, but I do have a couple more, and where is Barb? There she is. I'm going to let Barb come up and give her announcement first.
Grandview Nursing Home and Rehab need volunteers. They have three small flower bed areas that they need somebody to work on. You could volunteer to do just one bed, or if you're really ambitious, you could do three beds. There is irises they need dug up and things replanted, so if you're interested, call Grandview and ask for the activity director, Gail. They would love to have you volunteer. I don't dig in plants. I do house plants, but not outside plants. So if you have time and like to volunteer, they'd sure appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. She's our plant whisperer. He brings the plants that we try to kill off here in the church. She brings them back to life. But yeah, if you have an interest in gardening, if that's something that you really enjoy doing, then by all means, give a call out to Grandview, because they could certainly use your help. I have these couple of announcements. First of all, this came out of the conference, and they said, posed the question of how can we help the people in Ukraine or in Russia? And so they have these suggestions that I'm going to lift up to you. Oh. And that's the what you can give to, but they also suggest that you pray for the situation, that you hold them on your prayers and lift them up. And so we lift up that particular announcement. The other thing is, as I was talking about spiritual disciplines in my Wednesday worship class, and it has come to my attention that people don't know what I'm talking about when I say spiritual disciplines. And so let me just kind of take a step back. That means ways on how you might read scripture to be more meaningful for you, or ways of praying that might be different from what you're doing now, ways to journal and go deeper with your faith. And so they're just little practices that you might have. Yes, Wally.
Our spiritual discipline for Wednesday is what?
Our spiritual discipline for this Wednesday, if you would like to come, is we are going to fast for the day of Wednesday.
Did you forget, Wally?
No.
No, he didn't. He never forgets. So we're going to be fasting that day, and then we are going to break that fast at our Wednesday night worship with communion. And so we'll be talking about how fasting is a way to bring yourselves closer to God. So all are invited to our Wednesday night. And that's kind of what we mean when I talk about spiritual disciplines. Are there any other announcements that need to be lifted up this day?
I need to touch on
them. Okay. Yeah, just for your information, our email has been hit and miss again. We have a call in to try and get that corrected. And so we did send out an email that suggested that if you want to make sure that we get the message you're sending, to send it to our Gmail account instead. And we sent out that address. And so if you need that address from me, just stop me after the worship service and I'll get it for you. Any other announcements? Carol?
I just wanted to say that Mary Martha Circle, it says it's me, which we are, but Barb Green has arranged a speaker, and I don't have that information in my head, but she talks about holistic care for women, so it will be an interesting speaker.
So Mary Martha is this Wednesday at 9:30. They're having a speaker. They will speak on holistic care. Holistic what? Holistic care for women. And this is just a reminder to both you and Sandy that we have to do it at the microphone. Otherwise, the people who are seeing the live stream can't hear a word of what's being said. And so, just to kind of lift that up. So we'll repeat yours, and also Faith Circle will be meeting at 1:30 at Mary Abbey's, and they'll be doing the trivia of St. Patrick. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Correct. All right. Any other announcements this day? Then let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Please join me in the invocation and stand if you can, please. The invocation is in unison today. Hope in the Lord. Be strong. Let your heart take courage. Hope in the Lord. Now please join me in the opening prayer. Holy God, sometimes the journey demands much from us. Sometimes the path forward seems unclear. Sometimes the dangers we encounter are paralyzing. O God, walk with us and surround us in your love and grace. Strengthen us for whatever the path leads. In Christ we pray. Amen.
So we've come to our Bluestone moment for today. And again, our Bluestone moments are where we see God's love in action in our lives. And watching the news accounts concerning the tornadoes that we had a week or so, boy, you could see the love of God in action. Volunteers upon volunteers upon volunteers coming to help people whose lives have just been blown away and being there, helping them to find things, helping them to recover. Being the hands and the feet of God. And not only that, but the monetary donations that came in, or the donations of food, or the support, the water, all of those things. And you all know this, because you have gone through a tornado. And you know how important that is. And that is a very tangible, visible way that we can be the love of God for others. And so that's the Bluestone moment that I am lifting up this day. Would the children please come forward?
Give Andrew a chance to get settled here. I'm glad to see you all today. We're going to learn a Bible verse today that is so easy. When we get done, you'll be able to say it frontwards and backwards. It's so easy. But first, we're going to talk about something else. Now, you know what this is, right?
Yeah.
What is it?
A phone.
What kind of a phone? Oh, what kind of a phone is it? Ah, it's a cell phone. Now, just about everybody has a cell phone these days. Do you have a cell phone? No, not yet. Okay. When I was your age, I didn't have one either. And, you know, it's just been lately that just about every grown-up you see has a cell phone. And I'll bet all these people in the audience today have their phones with them, don't you? Yeah, uh-huh. Let's hope they remember to turn them on silent so their phone won't ring during church. Yeah. Everywhere you go, people are on their cell phones, aren't they? The other day I went to the dentist and there was a sign and it said, please turn your cell phone off during your visit. Now, can you imagine being at the dentist and getting a call? Yeah, that'd be kind of strange. Yeah, that'd be really strange. Could you talk on the phone while you're at the dentist? No. But people are on their phones all the time. And actually, they come in pretty handy. If I want to call somebody, I got all their numbers stored right in there. I just touch one. Oh, look at that, it lit up. Yeah. Did you see it light up? See? Yeah. I have all my friends' phone numbers stored in here, so if I want to call somebody, I just push one button, and there they are, just like that. Well, enough about cell phones. Let's talk about the Bible. The verse I want to teach you is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17. Here's the verse. Ready? Pray continually. That's it. Pray continually. I bet you can all say that, can't you? Okay, let's do it. Pray continually. Pray continually. Now, can we say it backwards? Continually pray. Continually pray. Kind of has the same meaning, frontwards and backwards, doesn't it? Pray continually, continually pray. That's right, they mean the same thing. Now, do I need my cell phone to talk to God? No, I don't. You're right. Yeah. Say that again, not everybody.
He doesn't even have a phone number.
No, he doesn't. So when I want to talk to God, how do I do it? Was that in the Bible verse? So if I want to talk to God, I pray continually. So whenever you see someone with a cell phone, and you see them all the time, you think, I could pray. I could pray continually, and I don't even need a phone. Let's finish with a prayer together. Dear Lord, we know it's important to keep in touch with you. Thank you for always taking our call. Help us to take your call even when we are busy. We love you, Lord. Amen. Thanks for coming up today.
The scripture reading today is from Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 through 21. Brothers and sisters, become imitators of me and watch those who live this way. You can use us as models. As I have told you many times and now say with deep sadness, many people live as enemies of the cross. Their lives end with destruction. Their God is their stomach, and they take pride in their disgrace because their thoughts focus on earthly things. Our citizenship is in heaven. We look forward to a Savior that comes from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. He will transform our humble bodies so that they are like his glorious body, by the power that also makes him able to subject all things to himself. Thus ends the reading. Thanks be to God.
Thanks to the chimes. So today I continue with my Lenten sermon series entitled Journeying to Easter Joy. Last week we talked about how faith is really a journey. I lifted up that sometimes the journey is easy, and then sometimes it's really challenging. Sometimes we pursue it eagerly with lots of energy, and sometimes we are just so tired and exhausted that we end up putting things on the back burner. Sometimes our faith feels vibrant and alive, and sometimes it feels like we need a little charging from the Energizer Bunny. Finally, sometimes we are on the journey, learning and growing, and sometimes we are stopped dead in our tracks because we are fearful and paralyzed. I remember when I was a child, our family would take a vacation, a yearly vacation to the North Shore of Lake Superior. To get to our campground, we always needed to drive around the base of Silver Creek Cliff, a rather steep cliff, and the road just kind of snakes around the edge of it. And there's the sheer cliff on one side, and there's Lake Superior about 3 football fields down on the other side. It was a rather harrowing kind of drive. And of course, nowadays, it's been corrected. They've blasted a tunnel right through Silver Creek Cliff, so there aren't any of those scary edges anymore. And so it's just not as exciting as it used to be, but it was quite memorable when I was a child. It was made all the more memorable for me because once you started to make that curve, well, there was this road sign just right there in front of you that would say, "Watch for falling rocks." Watch for falling rocks. Well, it seemed like a rather curious statement, an odd thing for people to be doing while they are driving. And as a child, those words tended to make me feel a little panicked. Perhaps the panic feeling came because every single time we came to that curve around the cliff, well, my father would say, "You better be on the lookout. Don't want any rocks falling on us." He thought he was so funny. I always thought, "Yikes," when he said that. For an imaginative young child, the very thought that rocks might fall on me, well, it made me want to duck under the car seat. I wanted to do anything to be safe from the falling boulders. Now, even with the wisdom of being an adult, I still don't really understand the point of a sign that's telling you to look for falling rocks. What good is it to be looking for rocks that are just about to hit you? Seeing it or not is not really going to make any difference. If we are in the path, well, too bad. All in all, for my mind, it is a rather useless road sign. It could be far better if it said, "Look for fallen rocks." At least stationary rocks can be avoided. I guess I have falling rocks on my mind because when it comes to our faith journey, I think faithful people can often have a "watch for falling rocks" kind of attitude. Too often, all we can think about are those falling rocks. What might happen if we respond with a yes to an opportunity or a nudge or a great big shove from God? And so we end up refusing it, refusing to do it at all because we don't want any of those rocks falling upon us. We let those fears about falling rocks, well, they control us. Our fear of them dictates what we will say, whether we will do it or not. We self-sabotage ourselves by telling ourselves that we can't possibly do that thing because of X, Y, or Z. We end up putting up all sorts of roadblocks so we won't have to face the insecurity of having all those falling rocks that we're worried about. It makes me think of those dreaded piano recitals I had to endure. I don't know if John Devlin's here, but I'm sorry. I know that I've talked about piano recitals before. They're kind of a part of what shaped me. But if you want to talk about falling rocks and roadblocks, I can't think of a better example. You see, at home, the piano recital piece would sound terrific. Not many mistakes, good dynamics, and I would know it by heart. I would always give myself a pep talk going into the recital. I would say, you can do this. It'll be fine. It's only for a few minutes, and then it'll be done. You've got this. And all would be well and good until I was sitting in a line with all the other scared and sweaty-palmed budding pianists. That's when the self-sabotaging talk would begin. You know, you really are a lousy piano player. You're going to make some real clinkers. You're going to forget the notes and the figurines and so on and so on. So many roadblocks erected, preventing success. And sure enough, by the time it came for my turn to play, I was a train wreck. I would play awful. It was a rather self-fulfilling prophecy. Another example, true confession. For the sermons that I preach, and I was having this conversation with Joyce, well, I always read them out loud ahead of time. And if there's a word I'm going to stumble over, it's out of there. It's gone. I replace it immediately with a different and easier word. I have learned through experience that no matter how much I practice, no matter how confident I am, when I stand up here in front of all of you, I will self-sabotage myself. I will tell myself, you're going to screw it up. And then I will mess it up royally. It always happens. Again, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. In our faith journey, too often, our response to how God is leading us is to set up the roadblocks, to tell ourselves messages that aren't true. A God opportunity comes before us. An idea for a possible ministry comes to mind. Or we're asked to serve in some sort of way, and in a heartbeat, we can psych ourselves out. We tell ourselves that there's no way we could possibly do that. And we tell ourselves we don't have the skills to do that. And so we miss an opportunity for growing in our faith. We miss a chance for living out of our faith in new ways. Perhaps it would be helpful to take a look at our gospel reading for today, to explore Jesus' attitude towards his mission and ministry, especially in light of Herod's desire to kill him. That threat was not to be taken lightly. It's no exaggeration to say that Herod was a rather ruthless individual. Historians describe Herod as being an insecure leader who would do whatever needed to be done in order to protect and maintain his power. Any potential threat was simply eliminated. And Jesus was a huge threat. Face it, the people were all excited about Jesus. He was giving them hope through all the healings he was doing. He was challenging the status quo. And he was catching the attention of the Romans. Never a good thing when it comes to Herod. Herod couldn't risk being seen in a bad light. So this Jesus person, well, he just had to go. Scripture tells us that the Pharisees were the ones who warned Jesus about Herod's desire to kill him. I try to imagine beyond what we've read in Scripture what the Pharisees might have said to Jesus. You're creating a scene. You're attracting attention. You need to stop this. Get out of town if you want to save yourself. Indeed, Jesus was heading straight into trouble. Look at that. There's a cedar wax ring. Why is that up there? Is that a sign of that I'm supposed to include this in my sermon? I like cedar wax rings. So Jesus was heading straight into trouble by continuing his ministry and by going to Jerusalem. And no way was he going to play it safe. He understood the danger, and yes, Jesus could have erected a huge roadblock. He could have told himself, oh, this is too dangerous. I need to stop. Tell himself, oh, I better throw in the towel. But he didn't. Jesus was not going to be deterred from his divine mission. There were still people who needed his healing. There were still people who hadn't heard his message of repentance and turning back to God. There were still followers that needed to learn his teachings. Bottom line, for Jesus, there was work to be done. And Jesus was going to do it. Nothing, not even a paranoid Herod, was going to get in his way. Jesus' reply to the Pharisees was that Herod is a fox. Certainly not the most complimentary of names, as foxes in the first century were kind of thought of as being sly and rather sinister. But we know that Jesus' name for Herod was not off base. Herod certainly shouldn't be trusted. Jesus wasn't afraid of Herod's threat, even though such a threat had powerful teeth behind it. Jesus knew it wasn't an idle threat. He knew what was going to happen when he went to Jerusalem. But still, Jesus continues his journey. He still makes his ministry, not his safety, his ministry the top priority. There will be no roadblocks put up by Jesus to prevent dealing with the many falling rocks that Jesus could envision. He will go to Jerusalem, the city known for killing God's prophets. There are many falling rocks that Jesus could envision. Certainly any one of those things could have caused major problems. But Jesus, he is committed to his journey. He will heed the call of God no matter where it leads, no matter how challenging it feels, no matter how threatening it becomes. He will endure the fear and the suffering, no matter what. For Jesus, fulfilling the work of God, well, that trumped everything else. So what about us? Do we have that same kind of dedication for doing the work of God? Of course, chances are good we will never face a life or death situation because of our faith. But can we live our lives, live our faith daily in the same commitment that Jesus models? Of course, we might say, well, you know, Jesus was the Son of God. He knew how his story would end, and so it had to have been easier for him. But I don't think that's true. There was a lot of pain and suffering ahead for Jesus, a lot of discomfort in the cards for him. And I think it would be natural to want to avoid those sorts of things. There were a lot of falling rocks for Jesus. And I'm sure he wasn't anxious to go through it. But he didn't erect the roadblocks. So can we follow that lead? Of course, it might help to name some of those roadblocks that we will go to. We might say, oh, we're too tired. Or it demands too much from us. We might say, we don't have the time, or it's too uncomfortable, or it's way too scary. We can't possibly do that. Or we may get all caught up with what will others think if we do that? Or maybe what will they think if I don't do it well? There is always that tendency to believe that somebody else, well, they can do it much better than I can. So ask them instead. Any of these statements sound familiar to you? They are the roadblocks that we put up to prevent us from having to experience those falling rocks the dread, the fear, the inadequacy. Letting those falling rocks control our response leads to a no, or a no thanks, or no I can't, or no I won't kind of response. We won't try it at all. Too often what we want is a comfortable faith, a less than demanding faith, a safe faith. But I hope you realize we shouldn't expect that if we plan to follow Jesus. We shouldn't expect it to always be easy when living our faith, because our journey will take us into situations that can be tough, that can be difficult, that can be challenging, that can be uncomfortable. You might end up in situations you never expected, doing things that you would never dream of doing. Following Christ demands a lot from us. So I get it. Sometimes it's just easier to erect the roadblocks and play it safe in our faith journey. Honestly, I think part of the difficulty comes from not really trusting that God will be present with us in whatever situation we find ourselves. You know, Christ does have our backs. Look at the image Jesus gives us to hold on to in Scripture. He says, I am like the mother hen who longs to protect my flock against all that would threaten them. Jesus wants to gather us in under his sheltering wings. What a beautiful image. Perhaps it's time for us to consider what we want Hope United Methodist Church to be. What it will be to the community. For myself, when the community hears the name Hope United Methodist Church, I want them to talk about people living their faith boldly. People who are loving others, caring for others, encouraging others, standing with others. I want them to know that Hope Church is filled with people who are answering God's call upon their lives. People who are making a difference for others. Let's stop focusing on the falling rocks and instead focus on and trust in God's love. Let's start believing that your actions, your willingness, your love, your care can make all the difference. What Christ wants are people who are modeling the love and acceptance of God. Modeling it to others. It's that simple. Perhaps we just need a little more practice in saying yes to those things that God places upon our hearts. So this morning, I want you to think about one thing that you love to do, one thing that you really enjoy doing, and then consider, how might I use that one thing for God? For instance, let's say you love to knit or crochet. Definitely not me. But if you love to do that sort of thing, well, then maybe you start knitting mittens or prayer shawls or socks or whatever to be given away to those who are in need of those things. Or let's say you enjoy writing. Now that would be me. Maybe you can start writing cards to our healthcare workers, to our police force, to care center workers, or to any group that is in need of some encouragement. Do you see how it works? No more roadblocks. No more fears of falling rocks. Stand up and serve God in whatever way you're able. Amen.
Thank you.
We have come to the time of the joys of and concerns of our community of faith, and I see Janine's ready with her microphone. If you have a concern or a joy that you would lift up this morning, just raise your hand and she'll come to you. Ray, over here.
I have prayers for a dear friend who is suffering from heart and lung problems at this time, and hopefully they will be able to help her as best they can.
Thank you. Other joys or concerns this day? Did you see something I didn't?
My steps in. Dr. Milton and I are so grateful for all the praying that you all did for him and me. He is doing well.
Thank you, Jenny. Other Joe, help up here by Lois. Or Lois, not I.
Prayers for a neighbor, Gary, who lost his wife and was suffering from great pain.
I would lift up prayers for Eileen and for Daryl. Eileen has been hospitalized.
Cheers. We have the joy of having our granddaughter here today who's home on spring break. This is Blythe.
Yeah, you guys look a lot alike.
Yes, Eileen is in the hospital over in Ames right now, and she's had excruciating kind of pain for the last week. It has nothing to do with her heart, but it has inflammation in her muscles, in her chest, and there's something else that's going on that they're trying to figure out what it is that is causing this pain, and she's on morphine right now, and she needs our prayers. And Eileen has had a great love for God and for Jesus Christ, and as a result of that, she carried on a ministry with those that were in prison here in our Hope Church, and she had a great love for trying to help people, and as a result, she helped Michael, who was in prison, and she helped him, and we both helped him, and probably $4,000 more of our giving to him to become a follower of Jesus Christ, and that is the challenge that we have as Christians, to help others and to overcome their sin and their grief. And I just recently wrote an editorial about being blind, you know. I've never have had so many compliments from so many people of what I had written about being blind. My grandson was blind at birth, and he had over 30 surgeries on his eyes, and each surgery was excruciating pain. But the interesting thing about my grandson was when he was in the sixth grade, he wrote an editorial to the Springfield Journal about global warming. And that was 30 years ago. He was not blind to the concerns of our world at such a young age, and how important it is that you and I not be blind to what God wants us to do. And please lift Eileen up in your prayers. I thank you for your support, and you are you're such a caring church, and I love your support at this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Daryl. Are there any other prayer concerns, any joys? I would lift up Deb H. Her father-in-law is recovering from COVID. I would lift up Dick, who is recovering from pneumonia. Lift up Lauren and Delane, who are being treated for cancer. I would lift up prayers for the students and the personnel of East High School in the wake of the shooting violence. Prayers for the family who lost their son, and prayers for the young women who are hospitalized with gunshot wounds. And I would again lift up prayers for the people of Ukraine and of Russia, for the elderly, for families, for children who are just pawns in somebody's quest for power. Will you join me in prayer, please? Holy God, help us to put our trust in you. Help us to know that your presence goes with us in all things. I know, God, that you want us to be committed full in to doing your work, but you also know, God, how difficult that sometimes can be for us. We worry, and so we put up the roadblocks that prevent us from following your lead. We say we're too tired, too scared, too inadequate. We don't want to do it, and it makes us feel uncomfortable. Oh God, we do have a lot of excuses, lots of reasons for avoiding your call, those things you place on our hearts. Forgive us for our lack of trust. Forgive us for our lack of belief, for our lack of energy, for our lack of commitment. Help us to know that with you, we can do whatever you are calling us to do. Help us to know that you are there with us. Help us to make you the number one priority in our lives. I pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have come to the time of our mission moment, and this Sunday is noisy offering, so if you have lots of loose change, just put it in our buckets, and our noisy offering will be going to, thank you for the sound effect, will be going to Zoe, Helping Children Help Themselves. It's an initiative in Africa, and what it does is it takes our orphaned and vulnerable children who are living in extreme poverty, and they give them skills so that they can break that cycle. It addresses 8 areas of life. It equips them to overcome poverty through their own efforts. And so they develop food security, secure housing, health and hygiene, income generation. They're connected to their community, they have rights as children, and they work with increasing their spiritual strength. And so that's where our noisy offering will be going this day. Our closing hymn will be Gather Us In. Please rise and join in singing. Spirit be with each and every one of you. Amen.